Welcome to the April 9th, 2018 business meeting of the Milford Board of Education. If we could please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you very much. So again, welcome to everybody. I will turn the meeting over to Dr. Feaser for student recognition.
Thank you, Mrs. Lennon, members of the Board of Ed, members of the public. So we are so thrilled to be here this evening to speak about wrestling and the fact that 4MI, for the second time in 3 years, is the Class M State Wrestling Champion, which is incredible in the state. So we have some wrestlers that are here this evening that I'd like to call up, who are the captains of the team and also obviously the collective of the entire team. And I know one of the coaches is here, yes, which is great. Noel Moot is here. My understanding is that Dave Esposito was supposed to be here as well, yes?
Don't know where he goes after the wrestling season.
So, well, let me begin. I'm going to call up Ronnie Gall and Cassine Khan, Ryan Luth, and actually, Mr. Luth, if you would come up as well as the assistant coach. Gentlemen, why don't you come over here? And there is another fourth captain, Will Morrow, who is not able to be here this evening. He actually is playing tennis, from what I understand. Lacrosse, excuse me. And so that's why he's not here, because he's playing lacrosse. So we are thrilled. Dave Esposito is the head coach. He hopefully will come within the next 10 minutes. And Anthony Vitale is here, principal, Mr. Berkowitz, assistant principal, Mr. Brennan. So we're thrilled. So let me tell you a little bit about this team. Who said lightning doesn't strike twice? Winning a team state championship twice in 2016 and then this past season in 2018 falls into that category. With hard work and perseverance, it can and it did happen for the 4MI wrestlers. Another exciting wrestling season took place again this year for 4MI. This just doesn't get old. This very talented and athletic group of wrestlers makes it fun and engaging for us to follow year after year. It's amazing to me how much time, energy, and true grit these athletes give to their sport, but the results speak for themselves. Tonight, we have with us the team captains from this year's Class M State Championship wrestling team. Again, seniors Ryan Luth, you want to raise your hand so they know who's who? Ronnie Gall, Cassine Khan, and again, Will Morrow is not able to be here. All the student athletes on this team work together like a well-oiled machine. Encouragement, leadership, talent, and the sheer will to succeed make this team what it is, winners. In addition to their team achievement of earning the state championship for 2018, I'd like to share with you some individual highlights of these young men for you from this past season. They're all seniors, and I know you will be impressed. Will, who is not able to be here, earned third place in the Class M state tournament and the 100th career win achieved at the 2018 state tournament. These are high school kids, so imagine this, 100th career win. Ronnie Gall, who's here, his weight class was 160 pounds. Placed second in the Southern Connecticut Conference Tournament and sixth place in the Class M Tournament. Cassine, 220 pound weight class, second place in the Southern Connecticut Conference Tournament, second place in the Class M State Tournament, fourth place in the State Open Tournament, which the Open Tournament is after the State Tournament, if I have this correct. And the Open Tournament, you're competing individually, not necessarily as a team.
Yeah, it's all classes, S, M, double L, and L. So the top six champs from there go and they all wrestle together at the Open.
So it's even that much more
determined who your ultimate state champ is.
Okay. And then Ryan weight class 152 pounds. He's the Southern Connecticut Conference champion. He received the most outstanding wrestler award at the Southern Connecticut Conference tournament. He's the Class M champion, received the most outstanding wrestler award at the Class M championships. He's the state open champion. He's the state record holder in victories, 220 wins, 19 losses. Unbelievable. This is at the high school level. He's the recipient of the Connecticut High School Coaches Association Wrestler of the Year. And he's the New England champion. He won this title last year as well, but this year he won it by a score of 2-1 in triple overtime. The New England champion. He's earned 4 individual champion titles this season alone. So incredible. I think all of you would agree that these are some amazing young men here before us. Not only are they outstanding athletes, but all will be continuing on to college next year. Will Morrow will be attending Mississippi State, where he will study architecture. Ronnie will be attending the University of Connecticut and will major in nursing and would like to specialize in the area of orthopedics. Kasim will be attending the University of Connecticut and plans to major in computer engineering. And Ryan will be studying at Washington and Lee in Virginia. Although he hasn't decided yet on a major, possibly the area of business, we do know he will be wrestling for the Generals. What wonderful high school careers these students have made for themselves, as well as memories they will never forget. There are some terrific futures lying ahead for this group. We also need to recognize that these are the 4 captains, but who they led are the team. And so we need to recognize the team also, because you don't win a state championship with simply 4 people, as you well know, even though they were outstanding. It takes the whole team of wrestlers, because it's combined points. I'm going back to when my brother wrestled years ago, as well as being a high school principal. So the young men that are on the team, beyond the captains, we want to congratulate them publicly for their work, for their perseverance, for their support of one another. My understanding is the camaraderie, the love, in the best sense of the word, with respect to each of the guys on the team is just remarkable, and the envy, I think, of lots and lots of teams across the state. And it's part of that intangible piece is so imperative when it comes to a state championship. And they're a model, I think, for every other team in the district. I also want to take this opportunity to recognize head coach Dave Esposito and assistant coach Noel Luth. Coach Esposito has been named by the Connecticut High School Coaches Association as the 2018 Class M Coach of the Year. Year in and year out, Coach Esposito is a guiding force to develop winning teams, and during that time fosters the athletes in their personal and academic growth. I also know that he and Coach Luth do a lot with respect to having the team give back in some fashion annually to the community. Assistant Coach Luth also plays a very instrumental role in the success and lives of foreign wrestling teams and its athletes. He has been selected by the Connecticut High School Coach Association as the 2018 Class M Assistant Coach of the Year. So both coaches of the year from foreign high, which I don't think all happens very often. So again, their devotion, skills, endless hour of time given to our student athletes is nothing short of admirable. It's clear why both coaches are multiple time recipients of these respective awards, and we are just so proud to have young men be shepherded by these coaches and to be able to achieve in the way that they've achieved. So congratulations to these young men here, but to the entire wrestling team for their accomplishment this year.
Congratulations. Thank you. 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 Congratul
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you.
Congratulations.
Congratulations. All right, thank you so much. Now we move on to student reports. Foreign was first. Is Foreign here? Foreign?
I don't think so.
You're not here, okay.
But I think Mr. Berkowitz has one piece of news he'd like to share.
Yes, Mr. Berkowitz, you want to be our speaker tonight for your school?
I only have a couple things.
Okay.
The May report is going to be fantastic.
All righty.
First of all, sorry they left, but I want to tell you that I told them before personally that that team is probably a once-in-a-generation team. And, you know, the wins, we obviously won two state championships, which we're very proud about. But Mr. Vitale and I always talk about how that is a true team. You know, they come together, they stick together, they support one another. It's really an amazing thing. So when I say once in a generation, I've been in education for 25 years. That group of students that's graduating with Coach Esposito and Coach Luth, pretty amazing. So I think you should know that. Do you agree? I knew we would. One other thing that Dr. Fieser asked me to mention to you, which I think is something that does not happen often. We have a student, Gene DeGuzman, one of our best students at Foreign High School academically. Fine young man. He just recently was accepted into Yale, Dartmouth, and Brown.
Wow.
So that's obviously extraordinary accomplishment and something that he should be very proud of, and we're very proud of him. Thank you.
Great. Thank you for sharing.
Thank you.
All right, Law?
Let's see. So we'll start off with our school counseling department and career center news. So on March 22nd, we'll have their college fair, and 144 families attended, and 94 colleges and universities participated. Two information sessions were held during the evening, with one session on NCAA standards and another on financial aid. Let's see. There was a trip to the NACAC National College Fair in Hartford at the Connecticut Convention Center on March 28th. Over 30 sophomore and junior students participated, and this event allowed students to connect with over 250 colleges and universities from across the nation. In college news, over the past several weeks, there have been more students reporting college acceptances. Mount Ida College, Quinnipiac, Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute, Drexel University, Purdue, Springfield College, Louisiana State University, and California State University, to name a few. And school counselors are completing meetings with junior students and families for post-high school preparation and planning, currently planning, organizing the upcoming AP test days in May. Let's see, so academic news, updates from Law's Media Center, we'll do that. So the Law Book Club book this month is Thunderhead by Neil Schusterman. The Friends of the Milford Library will be honoring two of our students, junior Monica Pidepati, and senior Frankie Terrez, for their academic achievements and civic engagement. The ceremony will take place on April 25th at the Milford Library. And approximately 50% of students at Law have visited the support center this year for help with skills and content in mathematics, drafting and revising and writing, and organizational study skills to become stronger academically.
In athletic news, spring sports have finally started their regular seasons after a few weeks of bad weather. The baseball and softball teams are both off to good starts, with baseball with a record of 2-1 and softball undefeated at 1-0. Both the boys and girls lacrosse teams are also off to solid starts, with the boys at a record of 2-1 and the girls at 1-1. Boys and girls track have about 20 state qualifiers already after their first meet. The golf team had some low scores, which is good. in their first match of the year last week as they look to qualify for both the SEC and CIAC's championships again this year. The weather has been toughest on our tennis teams as our boys have only played one match and our girls team played their first match this afternoon. Both our young teams looking to have qualifiers for the SEC and CIAC tournaments. Booster Club named Jordan Beck and Ed Plathnov Scholar Athletes of the Month for the month of March. Catherine Burns and Justin Goglia were named Scholar Athletes of the Week for the SEC. Congratulations to all.
All right, so Law Amazing News now. We had our student walkout at Law, and we participated in it nationally on March 14th. Let's see, Senior Cotillion was March 19th and was successful and fun night for all. The SEC Scholar Leaders Awards were given to seniors Ore Opiame and Carl Maxwell. On April 2nd, Law participated in the World Autism Day. And let's see, Spring Musical, Shrek the Musical, this weekend took place with three nights of the show. And they were all showstoppers with the Law Drama Club. Very successful and packed the whole house. And Richard Ong won the Past Governor's Award for Outstanding Key Club Officer for the 2017 and 2018 school year. Richard was the only student in the state of Connecticut given the prestigious award.
On this past weekend, the Law Science Club participated in the Science Olympiad at UConn. Law's A-team placed 13th overall and the B-team placed 17th. Maddie Butts and Grace Pacelli placed top three in the Reddit Duo portion, and Ming Mei and Abby Bernstein also placed top three. Congratulations to Colin Hugo and Maddie Baldieri, who were honored last Tuesday at the Connecticut Association of School Award for Outstanding Arts. The Connecticut Association of Public School Superintendents Award winners were Grace Pacelli, Matt Turnus, and Megan Ajeladonki. Jonathan Law is pleased to announce that Mr. Brian Frank was selected for Teacher of the Year at Jonathan Law, and Mr. Charlie Murphy was selected for the Paraprofessional of the Year. Also, congratulations to Law's Parents of the Year, Mr. and Mrs. March. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Feel free to depart or have some homework to do. You know, pretty soon you won't have to think about that for a little bit. All right, public comment this evening. Speakers may offer objective comments about school operations and programs. The board encourages speakers not to express personal complaints or defamatory comments about the Milford Board of Education personnel or any person associated with Milford Public Schools. Security issues and matters relating to negotiations and grievances will not be permitted. Consistent with the principles of the Federal Education Right to Privacy Act, discussion of students is prohibited absent parental waiver. Please be advised the meetings are live on Channel 78 on Cablevision and archived on YouTube. Please state your name and address for the record and limit your comments to 3 minutes.
Kathy Burney, 96 Centennial Drive. Forum wasn't here to give theirs, but I was at the Science Olympiad competition and Forum won 2 awards, just so you all know. So they did walk away. I believe it was 2 third place awards. So I think you should know, in addition to Law, Warren did win 2 awards. And also, I think this whole idea for Down Cemetery is an awesome idea.
Thank you.
That's it.
Okay, thank you so much. Any other people here for public comment this evening? All right, seeing none, we'll move on to Chair's report.
Thank you, Mrs.
Glennon. Here's your me first. I know you want to get out of here, but
I'm sorry.
I just want to remind the board that and the public that the process in our superintendent search is moving along. The leadership profile that was compiled from the focus groups and the online survey has been posted on the district website, and press releases did go out to the media. Everything's on track, and I want to thank the board again for your attention and your engagement for with this ongoing work. Are there liaison reports this month? Anybody? Okay, your turn.
So we're going to begin with the instructional highlight, and I'm going to turn this over to Mr. Burr.
Thank you, and good evening. As part of our efforts, administrative efforts, to make sure that we keep the board informed on major instructional changes, I've asked Mr. Scott to come this evening and give you an update on two important aspects of our program here in Milford. The first of which, and actually I think he's combined them into one presentation, is that correct?
Yes.
And so the first one, as you see in your agenda item, is some significant changes to social studies instruction that have taken place over the past few years, in which Connecticut has adopted recently as well. This is a change in not just in the standards, but also the approach to instruction. The nice aspect of this, and I'm not sure if you're going to touch on this, there is a parallel to some of the changes that occurred in the science, in the new National Standards for Science. So there's a new approach to instruction that I think that will greatly benefit our students, and I won't steal any more of Mr. Scott's thunder. A second element of that is some incredible work that the district is engaged in with some neighboring districts in an assessment. For those of you who are teachers or and studied it at all in an education school, we have a lot of instruction in instruction and planning, but not a lot of instruction or background in assessment building. So that's an area that most teachers, myself included, when I taught for 13 years, that it was not necessarily an area of expertise. So bringing in an outside entity to help us create some exciting new assessments, that doesn't sound, you know, it sounds like those two should go together. But yes, we have some exciting opportunities for our students through what's called a performance-based assessment. So without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to Mrs. Scott. And just so you know, I'm going to introduce some of the folks you've brought with you.
Yeah, we have some teachers here that participated in both of those. So when we get to certain sections, I'll have them introduce themselves. So as Mr. Burt mentioned, I'm going to talk about two different instructional highlights tonight. We're going to start off with the changes in social studies coming around right now. It is just a little one-page handout from the National Council for Social Studies. So in 2010, the National Council for Social Studies began drafting the College Career and Civic Life Framework, which became the National Standards for Social Studies. They're more commonly referred to as the C3 Framework. And then in 2015, the State Department of Education, Connecticut State Department of Education, drafted a state framework in which the standards fit and then adopted those. So the state framework was adopted in 2015 and the national standards were written in 2010 and 2011. I was lucky enough to participate as a member of the review committee for the Connecticut state framework. And our goal with the Connecticut state framework was to create some content and curricular connections in which the national standards could be connected to. They are not requirements because, of course, of local control. So the state framework are not a set of requirements, but rather a guide for districts to be able to create their own curriculum. As Mr. Burt mentioned, there's a great deal of crossover between the new National Science for Standards, the NGSS, and the C3 framework for social studies. And I just have a few of the highlights up there about some of the areas in which those two overlap. The really big emphasis in terms of both of these is in both the National Standards for Social Studies and the National Standards for Science, it's a move away from content standards and a shift to instructional practices. And in both the science and social studies standards, the emphasis is about student discovery. So both sets of standards, although they use slightly different terminology, both start off with students' abilities to ask questions, move on into areas of students making claims, students collecting evidence, and students backing up their arguments or positions. In social studies, those are referred to as the inquiry arc, and it's broken into the four dimensions, developing questions, applying disciplinary tools, evaluating sources, and then communicating conclusions and taking informed action. So we broke apart the standards a little bit more, just so you can kind of take a look at them. As I said, this is a really big shift for social studies. You may recall back to when you were in school and social studies was really all about content, memorization of dates, memorization of people's names, who signed the Declaration of Independence, all that kind of stuff. So we've really made a big break away from that, and we've really moved to the concept of students being able to develop questions, to be able to look at information as critical consumers of information, for students to be able to conduct meaningful research, and then also for students to be able to communicate their understanding. The taking informed action, which you see up there on dimension four, comes in many different forms. At our high school levels, we do try to encourage our teachers to guide their students into actually taking civic action. At the middle school and elementary schools, that's not quite as appropriate, but we still do try to find opportunities for students to become more involved citizens. So here in Milford, we began our work with this back in June. It was probably one of the first things that I did when I got here was to start the movement towards the adoption framework. We did a multi-day workshop in which we invited teachers from all levels, K through 12, to attend and participate in a three-day long work process. And we actually had an overwhelming turnout. We had teachers from all levels, almost all buildings were represented at the training. And I think the teachers really enjoyed the training. We shifted that training into something referred to as an ed camp model, where really many of the teachers themselves provided the professional development for each other, rather than it being me standing up there and talking about the standards. They really taught each other about the standards and conducted some research into it. Then starting in August, teachers began to rewrite units and lessons using the Milford Inquiry Blueprint, which we developed during that multi-day workshop. In December, a social studies curriculum review and advisory committee was formed. This committee will end up making the recommendations for what curriculum is adopted by the social studies department. In January, we developed a tool to assist the administrators in looking at instruction in the new social studies standards. And then in March, we did some model lessons around the new standards. So the last two I just want to talk about a little bit more in depth. One of the issues that we could see as we started to adopt to both the science standards and the social studies standards is that many administrators were not very well versed in the new standards and really needed some support in giving coaching and helping out with evaluation around the new standards. So we started to develop a tool of look-fors, and I'll pass that down to you, in conjunction with the teachers. In order to help the administrators to help the teachers in developing future lessons. We decided to do our demo lessons at the middle school level, and we had each one of the buildings participate. In each building, we selected one teacher who, with some support of one other teacher in their building, developed a lesson that was very specifically focused on one dimension of the inquiry arc. That way we would have the opportunity to go in and visit that classroom and see the teacher conduct that lesson. So I do have two of the teachers who participated in the model lesson, so I'll just have them introduce themselves real quick.
Hi, I'm Megan Flaherty. I teach 8th grade at Harborside, American History. I'm Sarah Carano. I teach 7th grade social studies at East Shore.
Michelle Burrell was not able to join us tonight, but she was the other teacher that was involved with the model lesson. So the first lesson that we developed and went to see was Michelle's lesson, and it was based on students developing questions. She used something called the question formulation technique, in which sixth grade students developed questions having to do with Egypt, and then revised those questions into really compelling questions that could actually guide deep and meaningful research. All of the teachers were able to come in and watch that lesson along with some of the administrators. Mr. Carano was in on that group that we went in. We then debriefed after that lesson and talked about the planning that went into that lesson. And then we moved on to Sarah's lesson. Sarah's lesson was about applying disciplinary concepts and using evidence. Her lesson was focused around the use of stations and literacy skills. Same thing, we all went in. We went in with some administrators as well. And then we debriefed afterwards. And then Meg's was the last one. And hers was called a tableau, which is actually a very old form of conducting a lesson, but it's been kind of reborn in the C3 framework. And the tableau is a way for students to communicate their discoveries through their research. In the particular one that Meg did, it related to the American Revolution. If anybody has any questions about the model lessons, I did say to the teachers that they could answer those questions for you. So if anyone has any questions about stations or about a tableau.
Mr. DeYoung?
I'm just curious if you could maybe go a little bit more in depth as to
what the lesson looked like, as far, you know, not just the technique, but...
As which one?
Anyone, I'm just curious, you know, how it differs from how social studies was previously taught.
I could jump in.
Yep.
When I took social studies, it was memorization of dates. And I will admit that I wrote the dates on my shoe and tried to get away with it. I was that kid. So now that I am a teacher, we do it differently, which is a great thing. So with the tableau, it was the American Revolution. We picked six major battles to focus on. They had to do graphic organizers on each one. With all the data, the days, we can't get away from that. But mostly the moment that mattered was what we're focusing on. They had to do research independently. Then they were put into groups randomly. They hated that. Where they had groups of three, and they got assigned a specific battle. And they had to come up with their own tableau, which is a frozen moment in time. Like charades, but you can't move. So they had to come up with how are they going to get the other kids in the class to know what their moment that mattered was and be able to guess which battle it was based on their movements, their facial expressions, how they positioned themselves. And then after that, the kids had to come up with their own questions. The whole class did, which was awesome using Google Classroom. So we were able to upload these questions ahead of time, and they were able to, you know what was expected, know what was coming. So they did three different levels, supportive questions, which are like we call Googleable. If you can pull out your smartphone and ask Siri, then that's the first level. Then we did semi-compelling questions and compelling. Compelling is something you really need to know. You can't bluff. You have to really get yourself into the moment. You have to know everything about your battle, and you can't fake it. So after the kids did their tableau, they were able to unfreeze, and then the class, the kids got to ask their peers questions, and they had to answer as the character from the battle. So they really, I did a feedback Google form afterwards, and being that it's a very out-of-the-box assessment, they really felt that they learned a lot, and they felt that they enjoyed it, and some of the kids who struggle more with writing were able to really show what they know as far as social studies go, so it was really great.
Thank you.
Sarah?
I created a stations activity centered around Confucius, China's greatest thinker, and Confucianism. And I believe strongly in utilizing multiple forms of text. So not just written text, but song lyrics and videos, and having kids really examine them and then go on to apply concepts and really kind of extract the evidence and engage in discussion surrounding their work. I mean, it is, as you can imagine, highly engaging. I mean, the kids were excited about their work, singing along to the lyrics and all that. I even think some kids shed tears as they were watching some of these very emotional videos, but of course, they were all very wonderful and helped to demonstrate Confucius's beliefs. But I really think that the takeaway was incredibly powerful. Confucius believed deeply in respect for one's elders, and treating others with kindness and all that. And so, I really feel as though this was perhaps the best way that I've ever approached him and his teachings. I sincerely believe that it's something that they're going to remember. So, yeah.
My recollection from the work we did with the Next Generation Science Standards was that the approach is much more student-led versus teacher-led, and really your role is to be more of a facilitator.
I have pictures if anyone.
If you're interested later.
Ms. Pinzens? I'm curious to know how you use, so I'm familiar with the QFT, and I was wondering how you used the end result of the student, created questions. Was it in the form of a test? Did they do something with it?
So for the first
excuse me, from the first lesson, Michelle's lesson, she did, the kids ended up using, so they, the way that we did the QFT with that particular group of sixth grade students was that they came to a group consensus around one question, so she had six groups in her room. So they ended up with six questions, and then those groups of students conducted research projects around those questions that they had selected. And it was really impressive to see the level of questions that the students could come up with at sixth grade, because, you know, anybody can ask a question. There was one particular group, you know, they started off with the question, were they the first to mummify people? Which was not really much of a question, but by the end they came up with, was the Egyptian culture unique in the process of mummification? And then the kids did conduct an investigation in that. They did a presentation comparing mummification across multiple ancient civilizations, in which they did sort of a comparative study of both the reasons behind the mummification and the process for mummification in different societies.
Other questions?
I have one more question.
Yep.
I'm sorry, and forgive me if I'm not understanding exactly. So it seems like some of this, even though it's more facilitating for the students, probably requires a lot more work to lesson plan.
Definitely the work comes to the planning now.
Yeah,
that's one of the things that we really wanted to have the teachers model for each other. You know, the amount of work that goes into planning a unit of this style is really a very large amount of work, and that was also a really important part of bringing the administrators in, because we wanted to make sure that the administrators could really support the teachers in that process. We involved the literacy specialists from the different schools. We involved some of the Library Media Center folks, because that collection of resources becomes a really essential part of that planning as well.
So do we give... Are we giving the teachers extra time to lesson plan?
We are not.
Fair enough.
Spinsense?
And you may be touching on this later with assessment, but have the teachers gotten any professional development or anything on rubric planning for projects like this, or?
Yep, we did. This past year and a half, we've spent a lot of our professional development time around the standards, but also around things like creating rubrics, creating meaningful assessments, giving feedback, and that also will tie over into the next instructional highlight as well around performance-based assessments, which are very much a huge professional development push that we made around assessment practices, feedback, authentic audiences, and things like that.
Federico?
Thank you. I just want to get a sense of the timing of this change.
Yep.
So going back to the days of memorizing dates versus today,
yep.
Is it an evolution over time, or is it really like 3 years ago they were memorizing dates and now we're doing this?
So it depends on if we look at it nationally, by a state level, or locally. So nationally, the shift really started to happen around 2005. For a long time nationally, social studies did attempt to come up with a set of standards or framework or content standards. And the difficulties during, you know, I've been teaching social studies for 23 years now. In the early part of my career, really no states could come to consensus as to what was important enough to say was in the national standards. So we just never had any national standards. But shortly after 2000, there was a greater push around civic education, was really where the traction started to grab hold in terms of the national standards. When the National Council for Social Studies really started building out the standards, though, they really started looking at 21st century literacy skills. So the idea of how do students conduct research and how do students communicate their learning as being the cornerstones of it, and then eventually the inquiry model. Which was very closely mirrored on the next generation science standards. Both were released about the same time. And then in terms of on the state level, it really went from 0 to 100 in no time at all. As a state, you know, as a social studies teacher in this state, for 18 years we operated with no state standards whatsoever. And then they passed in 2015 and that was it. So it was just a really large shift. Locally, I would like to say, I would like to believe, and they might disagree with me, that we've moved at a nice steady pace over the past year and a half. You know, I didn't want to come in and suddenly rewrite the entire curriculum and change everything, because I felt like, you know, we needed to take our time to make sure that we could put in the professional learning before we started rewriting the curriculum. So that's why, even though we've done a full, over a full year now around the professional learning, we're only starting to begin in rewriting the curriculum early this summer.
Okay, so just make sure I'm hearing this correctly. So if we go back, say, 3 years ago, it was still a memorizing dates learning?
Yeah, it was.
Sure, if it was, I would never become a social studies teacher.
Okay,
came up here from West Virginia in 2003, and I started at Harborside in sixth grade. And I walked in because I knew it was an interdisciplinary performance-based assessment school of learning and not memorizing dates.
Okay.
So my ancient world history class was not, when did Caesar die, when was he assassinated, but more like, what were the causes of his assassination? And let's role play, that was the student's favorite, role playing Caesar getting killed by his best friend. So it was performance-based from the beginning. I think the curriculum with the three schools coming together and actually us looking at each other's classes and being able to come into the classes with the new evaluation and the new rubrics, that has come along. And with our new standards, that they're going to be aligned. So we have three schools now all doing performance-based assessments. We're doing inquiry art. We've always had the kids ask questions. So it wasn't, 3 years ago we switched into that.
Okay, so it's been happening all along, just now the standards are there.
The standard shifted 3 years ago.
Yeah, and the curriculum will be now fitting the standards and the new teaching, which is not new, but it's more set in stone, so it's across the board.
Okay, all right, thank you.
If that makes sense. I didn't want everybody
thinking
we just need everybody
to memorize. Mr. Burt? Two things. Just the emphasis of how you approach that. I wonder if everyone of the teachers addressed this, because some of the criticisms usually made about the new social studies standards or the new science standards is that, you're going away from facts, and students need to know important dates, and they need to know important people, or else they can't be a citizen of the United States type of thing. So in terms of content, because that's the criticism, we're moving away from content is the criticism. If any of you could respond to that in this new way.
I can tell you with the Tableau, they had to know it. They had to know the people who were involved. They had to know the places and the dates and the times and how it fit into each other. So it wasn't just a date in, isolation. They had to know the entire picture, and they had to really be able to communicate that out instead of just writing it down quickly and then it's gone out of their brain. They really had to understand it and work with each other and communicate it out, which I think is way more lasting than just memorization of dates.
I don't think we're gonna go away from some content. I mean, the students might need to know the leaders of Athens during, when Sparta and Athens had the Peloponnesian War. What we wanna do is, what makes Pericles a great leader, and was he a great leader? Was he justified? Was it a democracy versus a, was it really democracy? Or, were some people not treated fairly or equally. So I think that we need content. That's not going to go away. I think the emphasis is on the skill and the way in which students are accessing the material now, which is basically online, through social media and things like that, and also trying to get the kids to actually own what they're giving and sharing with each other.
So if I may jump into your presentation, because I am your boss. So, okay, so I'm going to go first. So in reality, going back to theory of content, you used to, I took tests where I had to memorize things, regurgitate them, and then promptly forget them, because there was a lack of context. So what we're doing now is emphasizing that context of why are these things important, rather than just memorizing them for their own importance. So it's a matter of process, it's a matter of thinking. So you actually retain that information because you're using it in defense of something, you're researching it, then you have to explain it, and then you have to defend yourself, and you have to use it in an argument. So there's a lot of different processes involved, and we know that the way you retain information is because you use it, not just because you memorize it. So that's the shift in thinking. Instead of the end result being the content, it's the end result of being able to understand the content and then think about it and then really to articulate yourself in a way that I'm not doing. So, over to Betty.
Mrs. Federico, I just wanted to pick up on your question and add to, you know, what a teacher said here. While there were no social studies standards, I can tell you that when I came into the district 7 years ago, I mean, one of the pushes was to try and deepen kids' learning, and that was happening across kindergarten through 12th grade. So a huge push away from worksheets, a major emphasis on the kind of questioning that was being asked in classrooms, because there are levels of questioning, and you know, move away from recall to much more analysis and synthesis kinds of questions that kids were engaged in. Different kinds of tools that were being used, so one school adopting, academic conversations as a means to, again, get kids to do far more thinking. So the standards may have been missing in social studies, but across all disciplines, there was a huge movement to wanting to increase rigor in classrooms and to increase student engagement, and that the engagement be authentic. It wasn't sufficient enough to just put kids in groups. The questions that principals would ask or administrators would ask in classrooms is, well, what was the rationale behind the way you grouped your students, and did that contribute more to their learning than if they were operating individually? So that kind of work has been going on for a number of years. What I think the huge piece here is, finally there's a set of standards. The fact that Connecticut didn't have any social studies standards, it's mind-boggling, because it's sort of like the Wild West, each school kind of doing their own thing, and kids being held accountable to different kinds of standards based upon the local, decision making. So that, I think, is really now giving, much greater shape to the actual than curriculum. But a lot of what is being asked, the good news is that this is not brand new to our teachers.
Okay.
Oh.
Thank you. Other questions? Thank you all.
So the other important part of the work that's been going on with social studies has been the Social Studies Curriculum Review and Advisory Committee. So we have 34 teachers who are a member of this committee. The committee has met monthly starting in January, and we've had a designated purpose to each one of our meetings. This committee will end up making the recommendations for what the curriculum should look like in 5 through 12 social studies starting next year. And then also put together the rubrics and structures for the social studies assessments, common assessments, from grade 5 to 12. In May, as I just mentioned, the Social Studies Curriculum Review Advisory Committee will make their recommendations for the Milford Public Schools curriculum. In the summer of 2018, this coming summer, we'll start the creation of our 5 through 12 internal assessment framework, which will start off with a set of rubrics and then also assessments for designated grade levels. Over the course of 2018 to 2020, courses will be rewritten in order to match the national and state frameworks. The reason why we're doing this over multiple years is to ensure that there's no gaps in learning as we do the transition, because many of our courses are sequential courses. We have multiple U.S. history courses and multiple world history courses, and we don't want to rewrite all the courses at once and then have students, never learn about the Civil War or something like that. So we thought that might be an issue. So now the second instructional highlight is the
Scott, can we just see if there's any final
sure.
questions on the social studies piece? Because I have a couple. Go ahead, Ms. Federico.
Yeah. When we were talking before, you mentioned civics.
Yep.
And so that just prompted something that I thought of. From time to time, we get comments and the critique that people who, may not know what's going on in schools might say, our kids don't know civics. Our kids don't know, what they need to know to make them an informed voter or an informed civic participant. Can you speak to that a little bit about, just a little bit about what they learn and when?
Sure. So currently in our structure, in grades 4, grades 5, grades 8, and then also in high school, students do receive specific civic lessons or civic education. There are designated units around state government and federal government at all of those levels. All students are required to take an American government or civics course in order to graduate from either of our high schools. So those are all in place currently. There will be no major shifts in terms of that. You know, those courses will still exist, and there will still be a very strong emphasis on civics in grades 5 and grade 8, which are both American history courses. So in terms of the quantity of a civic education, it's certainly not going to be minimized in any way. The important part of the shift to the new standards is that one of the disciplinary lenses that students will be looking at evidence through is a civics lens. So actually students will have greater exposure to what are their duties and responsibilities as a citizen across all social studies courses, rather than just in those designated spots in the curriculum as they exist now.
Okay. I wanted to ask, you mentioned the Milford Inquiry Blueprint.
Yep.
Is that something, a document that we could see?
Sure, I can share it with you. We created it based off of a combination of the inquiry arc and then also a more traditional UBD form, and it was used in the summer training in order to help teachers have some structure around the units they were creating.
Great. And when you're talking about the creation of the 512 internal assessment framework, so internal assessments, you're talking more about, like, would this be something like an old chapter test, or?
Well, there'll be common assessments, so every student across the grade levels will take them. Our hope is to create a series of rubrics that will be grade level specific, but will cover the designated dimensions of the inquiry arc, so it would be appropriate to use it in different grade levels, because obviously, in terms of cognitive capacity, we can't really expect a student in fifth grade to produce the same type of work as we would see a senior in high school produce. So the rubrics will have to be articulated vertically in order to be developmentally correct, but they will be based around the four dimensions of the inquiry arc. So it will be a big shift away from something like a chapter test. It will be more based around inquiry and research.
Mm-hmm. But when you're speaking of this, this is what would inform their grade, for instance, for the course.
It is more used in order for us to be able to measure students' mm-hmm. progress through the standards, but it certainly is an assessment that mm-hmm. teachers will use in their classroom, not unlike the common assessments that the teachers use currently.
Okay, thank you. Any other questions? Ms. Pinzens?
Just a quick comment. We've been hearing a lot about, you know, 5 through 12 or even down to 4, but big shout out to third grade in Milford, because my son became Harriet Tubman for a day. He was just so into it, and I mean, he's in awe of her at this point. And there was so much research and and really transforming himself into her, short of he would not wear a dress. But I went and saw their presentations, and they're doing exactly what you guys are talking about. So even if you're not directly working with them, it's definitely trickling down. So I love that.
I have a third grader too. Sam Ponto.
Yeah, it was really great to have so many elementary school teachers attend our workshop. You know, when I first built the workshop, you know, I had a fair amount of confidence that my middle school and high school teachers would show up. But with the elementary school teachers, where for some of them it is such a small portion of their day, you know, it was my hope they would attend, and they did, which was really great, because I think that we have started to see some of those impacts on what kids are experiencing.
Other questions? Ms. Hennessy?
I'm sorry, I might be like looking way ahead to the future here, but when you mentioned that the rubrics were aligned to standards and not example for content, is Milford looking to move towards standard-based grading at some point in the future, or is that?
That wouldn't really be part of this. These set of standards would be to measure our growth towards the national standards in social studies. You know, in terms of the standard-based grading that we see at the elementary school, I don't know that that is really an intention with the middle school and high school at this time. But, you know, it is definitely the idea of a vertically articulated piece of standards in which we're measuring whether or not students are capable of reaching the appropriate levels that they're supposed to be. You know, when we have national standards and state standards that were adopted, it is our responsibility to ensure that the students can meet those standards before they graduate.
Thank you.
Yep.
All right, thank you.
All right. So the other instructional highlight this evening is the Inter-District Performance-Based Assessment Innovation and Lab. So we began this work last year, so those of you who were on the board last year may remember us talking briefly about this work that we started last year. So we worked in conjunction with the Stratford Public Schools and the Amity Regional School District in order to provide an opportunity for teams of our teachers to work with a group called Learner-Centered Initiatives out of Long Island with the purpose of really creating an opportunity where not only our teachers would engage in some really meaningful professional development, but also have some strong, dedicated, and supportive time to create some really important assessments. So that's just some pictures from last year's workshop. You may recognize a couple of people in the pictures. Our administrators actually participated in some of the days around the workshop as well. So we had 45 teachers in total participate in the lab, 15 from each one of the three districts. Most of the teachers did work in collaborative partnerships or small groups in order to create something that would be interdisciplinary and be consistent across a grade level. So the one I asked the teachers to come in and talk about briefly tonight was, I think, one of the real highlights, and you may have seen this come across your email. So West Shore Middle School, and we have some teachers here from West Shore Middle School, and I'll have them introduce themselves in just a minute. They participated in the Inter-District PBA workshop, and they created something called the Zombie Apocalypse. When it came across your email, you probably were asked to watch a video and hopefully vote for our contestant for the Follett People's Choice Award, and we did win the Follett People's Choice Award, including a grant that went to the school. And the teacher, I'm going to have the teachers introduce themselves that worked on that project and talk a little bit about it.
Hi, I'm Catherine Susan. I'm from West Shore. I'm a seventh grade social studies teacher. I did teach sixth grade at Harborside for 11 years, and I moved to West Shore when they combined them. Language arts and social studies classes, and I moved to Mr. Donato's, Vaselli's seventh grade class. I just want to apologize for the grammatical error on there because my pet peeve, and that was my fault because I think I gave you an older version. this was an amazing program that we did this summer. Amanda Torres and I worked, spent a few days learning how to do a performance-based assessment, which we all know how to do it. But the actual time that we got to have and actually doing it is what really inspired us to create this. And with the help of Lisa Vecino and Mr. Paul Cabana, who was in our zombie show at the very beginning, he was the one who declared our emergency, we worked. The kids had an amazing time, and the sixth graders and seventh graders really enjoyed teaching each other, learning from each other. They were excited, they were engaged physically with the physical education, the health part with the emergency planning, and the social studies with the five things of geography. I couldn't have had a better team. This was amazing, and with Mr. Scott's blessing to take a risk and have these kids really own this and create this, and with the Media Center being a war zone itself. We went upstairs on the second floor. We had the green room in the hallway during, you know, quiet time. It was fun. The kids had a blast. We had so much fun. I just want to thank Ms. Vecino for putting the video together and teaching my students how to use the green room. And now we have a real green room screen downstairs in our wonderful media lab. And I just couldn't have asked for a better team. I just want Ms. Vecino to just say some things about what she was able to do in the small amount of space with our wonderful school.
We did only have a closet.
I'm
Lisa Vecino, the library media specialist at West Shore. The seventh graders were focusing on geography. So they were focusing on the themes of geography, which they had started at the beginning of the year. So by early October, they were taking their learning and they created videos. We used the green screen technology in a hallway. When the bell rang, we set it up, and then when the bell rang again, we moved it over. So we made use of very tight spaces, but the kids learned how to use the green screen, and they wrote news flashes that they then shared with the sixth graders, because the sixth graders were having to deal with health emergencies and natural emergencies. So the seventh graders used their geography and they told the sixth graders how to escape this experience that was happening in Milford. It was starting in New York City, but we talked about, you know, the trains and where we live and how people commute and why this could be such an issue for us, and zombies could get on trains. We wouldn't even know they were a zombie yet because there was a wait period, we wouldn't know. And so the kids had a lot of fun with the whole idea of the zombie, which, you know, that engaged them and kept them going. But they thought about how to move across areas, how to go to different places, what they had to think about with those geography terms. And then they made their own videos. They came up with the scripts, they embedded the facts, they filmed it. Some of them, we had one young man that was, he put himself in a helicopter over New York City, over a harbor, and was telling people to go to, I think it was Rikers, because that was cement and it would be safer there. But they really just, they loved what they were doing. And then they went and they informed the sixth graders, which added a whole new, another dimension to it. This was many weeks of many lessons, many planning, and oh, we're gonna scrap that, we're gonna try it again. And then Ms. Torres, she had her sixth grader. So if you want to mention what the sixth graders had kind of come with.
Sure, so I teach health education at West Shore, and you know, it was really fun for the sixth graders because we were able to learn a lot about social studies through the seventh graders, and they were really able to facilitate this whole activity for the sixth graders to experience. Mr. Cavanna, we made a video where you didn't get to see it in the video we put together, but we had tons of different footage we kind of mixed together for the kids, where he came over the speaker telling the kids, like, we have a code Z, zombies are infiltrating the borders of Milford, and set this whole stage for the kids, and we were able to simulate a whole disaster situation. And what was really cool was we got to focus a lot on the whole process of an emergency situation and look at like communication skills and decisions that you'd make. And we had zombies, we had medics in the center that the kids had to go through this whole course. And if they got tagged by zombies, during the course they were collecting pieces for an emergency supply kit on their team in order to survive the zombie apocalypse. And if they were tagged, they'd have to barter with medics in the center of the map and trade supplies in order to get an antidote, you know, to get rid of this whole zombie infection and be able to continue on their journey.
And they ran around and around.
And they were crazy.
It was amazing.
I mean, and what was really nice through this whole opportunity over the summer is it gave us a lot of time to really think and prepare, because it is, like you're saying, tons of planning that goes through it, but the whole process, I mean, you don't have to deal with any behavior problems, any craziness. The kids love it. They leave class like, oh my gosh, can we do that again? And they learn a lot through the whole process. And it's honestly, I presented at our state conference for health and phys ed teachers and our regional one last week, and other schools, when they see some of the great things that we're doing here in Milford, are like blown away by the amount of work that really goes into like setting up a whole like situation like that for the kids, and they're kind of like, how do you have time to do some of this stuff? I'm like, well, we work for a really cool district that gives us time over the summer to be able to like collaborate and plan. It was really, really cool. If we had a little bit more time, I'd almost say, we'd do the whole process again, because it was really nice assessment-wise for the kids to be able to think about, like, wow, in a real emergency situation, you know, how important it is to stay together and effectively communicate with your team and to really think about the choices that you're making. And some of the things that maybe they didn't think about initially, and maybe let them re-go through the experience again and look at some of the predictions that they made. And actually, Lisa actually helped us out too. We brought a bunch of our kids to Pumpkin Delight.
And they made their own videos about what do you do with your pet when there's an emergency. And because of us living in West Shore, and unfortunately hurricane storms over the last years, the kids, that meant something to them. Well, I couldn't go to this place because of my dog, or what was I gonna do with my cat? So they made little videos to share with the third graders to say, this is what you do, how do you plan, have a kit for them, this is who you call. And We actually just put their name in for one of the Mayor's Youth Awards because as a group they went over and they presented that. And so that was that learning that just kept going. And the students then became the teachers again. So, you know, when you talk about that performance-based learning, it is meaningful and it matters to them and they're vested in it and it just keeps going.
And actually, for the content, it provides so much more depth. Like, it gives the kids so much motivation to learn everything because, you know, you're not going to survive a zombie apocalypse really well if you don't know the information that we're going to be asking you and prepared for. So you're going to kind of let down yourself and your team, you know.
So what were the content areas?
The five themes of geography. Mm-hmm. So movement, human environmental interaction. Place, location. We use Plum the Worm. So place, location, human environmental interaction, region, and movement.
Well, we focused it on Milford. So like how you would actually survive an emergency situation in Milford. And we brought in like from the Milford Health Department, we brought in somebody that trains people in CERT, community emergency response teams in the community. And we looked at, you know, where are our shelters in Milford if there was an emergency, and what would you do, and where would you go? And it was really, in the whole process, it was kind of interesting because I gave all the kids like a scavenger hunt sheet and put them on specific teams, and they had to follow the sheet so I could make them really move and run around this map to collect supplies. But in a real emergency, they would have really, you know, picked their own people to kind of hang with in a real emergency situation. So we talked about like what was realistic, what was really maybe unrealistic in an emergency situation too. What were some things that we couldn't really simulate? We looked at a lot of stuff.
We created a lot of maps for Milford. And actually I used some of the information from East Shore, Melissa Rossi, who I am doing a PLC with. She actually found the regions that the kids are gonna end up. So her kids actually created posters of the North Dakota versus Arizona, so using the five themes. So I brought that information into my students, but my students were trying to save West Shore, East Shore, and Harborside, and we figured Harborside was going to probably be attacked first because of the subway train. East Shore was on its way north with Sikorsky planes, and we had the harbor, you know, with the Coast Guard, so we used a lot of maps. They created their own maps. And they showed them to the class, and they were able to explain to the sixth graders.
And I think that communication piece too, because the seventh graders on the day of the event were outside, and they were the ones that were, you know, posing the questions, and they were the leaders, and they were articulating and able to share information. So it was that whole piece of, you know, the students are speaking and listening, and that was all part of it too, even with the video. So it just seemed to tap into so many parts of good learning.
These are skills that are going to carry them through for a long time, so it's awesome.
Yeah, we have the last session of this year's Inter-District PBA workshop coming up fairly quickly, April 27th, and we'll be having a showcase on that day in which the building administrators will have an opportunity to come and see the work from all three districts. Actually, three different assessments from this workshop all were presented at either regional or national conferences this year. So there was some really impressive work, you know, the West Shore one, as well as two other assessments being really exceptional in that process. So we are continuing the inter-district performance-based assessment workshop. This year, we're going to be sending three specific teams to the training. We're going to be sending a grade 5 team, a grade 6 team, and a grade 9 team. Each one having a little bit different approach than we did last year. Last year, we really approached it with a little bit more of a loose grouping in terms of who went. This year, we're going with a much more targeted approach in the hopes of getting some very specific tasks. So for grades 5 and 6, we're looking, we're hoping to walk away with some interdisciplinary research-based tasks, very much anchored in the science and social studies standards. And then grade 9, the work we've engaged them in is trying to reimagine what midterm exams might look like. So right now, our high school midterm exams still look pretty much like you'd think of a high school midterm exam looking like. So we're really trying to hope for an opportunity where they can kind of take some time, as these teachers did, and have some support and have that structure in order to create something very different for our grade 9 students. That's it.
The zombie apocalypse, that was prior to this board, right? Can we circulate that video again? Is it possible
sure.
to do that so that
Absolutely.
We could, the other board members could see it?
I voted, well, some
sure,
of us did.
Thank you.
That was
the prior board.
I know.
No, we did. The prior board.
I think we did see
did
it.
Did you see it?
Yeah.
But it was that was prior to the election, wasn't it? When was the voting? What time?
January.
This year? Okay. Okay, then it was this board. It was that.
Thank you, everybody,
seems like
for
it was,
voting.
Seems like it was a long time ago. So. All right, so we have seen it. Did
I just
you
had,
miss it?
No, I guess
okay.
I saw it. I did see it, and I did vote. I promise.
I believe you.
Please,
we
do.
We won.
Okay. Don't send any zombies after me, please. So the zombie apocalypse sounds like it was absolutely amazing
yep.
and an opportunity for the students. Is it something that there are plans to do in the other schools, the other
yes.
middle schools?
Yep, we're hoping that it will be something, you know, as Catherine mentioned, they brought it to from West Shore to East Shore last year. We're hoping to expand it to all three middle schools this year. That was one of really, seeing some of these assessments that were developed somewhat in isolation really flourish and do so well was part of the reason we went with a slightly different approach in terms of the teaming this year, so that our hope is that having teams for multiple schools but around one grade level, our hope is that we can develop ones that will exist in multiple buildings immediately rather than the gradual growth process that we did this time.
Thank you. That's great.
Any other questions? Ms. Federico?
Thank you. I just want to say I think it's all fantastic, and I love innovation, and I love that you're getting into looking at different ways of doing things, and you know, very supportive of that. I want to offer one word of caution if you're looking at the grade 9 midterms.
Mm-hmm.
I know that if you want to do it a different way, that's great. I know there was one year where they got rid of midterms for grade 9, and from what I heard, my own personal experience, but mostly what I heard, the finals that they took in grade 9, they did not do well.
Mm-hmm.
So just a word of caution to keep that in mind, whatever you do with the grade 9 midterm, make sure that they're still prepared to take a final, because for those kids in that class, I think it was a shock to their system
mm-hmm.
when they got in and took their first final exam not having a midterm.
Yep.
So just a comment.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Other questions? Comments.
So if I could just quickly respond
mm-hmm.
to that,
I
want to help the board understand that we need to be progressive in our assessment practices. And when pressed about exams, why do we even give exams? The majority of the responses are, well, we need to prepare them for college exams. So in that example you just gave, well, we need to give them a midterm so they're ready for the finals, so then we can get them ready for their exams, so then they can go to college and take exams. So what is the purpose of that assessment? You know, so that's the conversation we're having as a district, and we'll continue on, you know, past my tenure here. It really is about, so we're taking 4 days in midterm and 4 days at the end of the year to do half days and to give these assessments that, in essence, count for a small portion of their overall grade. Are they high quality assessments, or are they really telling us about our students' achievement? So when we talk about the mid-year assessments, it's really to say these should be high quality assessments that do more than just the rote memorization, spit them back on a multiple choice, and then give us some basic information of whether they memorize some content. So that's the direction we're headed. We want to ensure that these experiences are valuable as for the students, as well as give us that information back, and not necessarily just to prepare them to take college exams. I understand there's an aspect of that. The majority of our students do go on to college, but we're really here to make our students the best that they can be, and have the best skills that they can to go on beyond college and be very successful in life. So it's a balancing act, and we have this ongoing debate about all these issues, but I wanted to pose that to the board and not just say, to give you that insight that that's some of the conversation. It might take 3 or 4 years for us to get to an answer, but that's what we're discussing in the district.
Yeah, I that makes a lot of sense. I'm glad that you explained it that way. I appreciate it. You know, I just think of it from the perspective of, you know, what it does to the students' grades as we're trying to find the right solution, just to give, be careful with that. I'm sure you are.
No, I'm not, I'm leaving.
Mr. Pulaski?
It's getting easier to say.
Mr. Pulaski?
Yes, I just had a quick question. Has there been any sort of negative feedback from parents of the students involved in the zombie apocalypse and they're on the use of zombies in an educational setting?
If anything, I mean, during parent teacher conferences, it's one of the things that kept being brought up is the excitement of the kids. It's the only thing they take home with them. It's, you know, every day, what did you do in class? They nothing, but they were more than welcome to talk about the zombies. And what I liked about the zombies is that it's not real, but there's so many historical, you know, science, neurology, and all these backgrounds that we can put into it interdisciplinary-wise. If we didn't have to scare them with the real terror that's going on in the world, we can make connections to it and give them a little bit at a time. But sixth and seventh graders, they needed something at the beginning of the year to kind of get excited about, not bring them down. So that way, when we go into the real natural disasters, they have something that they can think of that was fun for them, but still something that they learned. But we didn't have any. I mean,
so think of the zombie as the hook.
Yeah.
And then the learning happens, you know, post the zombie piece. So we looked at the video clips, and it's not that you see, like, bloodthirsty zombies.
We didn't even show any of that.
Just to spark their interest.
Okay.
Yeah. That's a good point.
Yeah, and we were aware of this. You know, I mean, I don't watch The Walking Dead for that reason. It's traumatizing me, so.
Any other last comments? All right, well, thanks. That was a wonderful presentation. Did you have some consensus?
Is there any, you know, I envision, obviously, this takes a lot of work, and it covers a lot of material, but probably not a chunk of material that was already existing. So, like, you're pulling from all different aspects of intercurricular, you know, topics. So it's something that you may have covered in the beginning of the year last year, and at the end of the year may have also been a piece of this puzzle, right? So would you then go cover it again, or is this something that, like, as these lessons develop, you'll take a look with your team at the entire curriculum for the year and say, okay, if we can do, you know, 8 projects throughout the year, where can we place all of our content topics within that? And now we're only doing these projects, but they've got the entire content. I mean, how long does that take? That takes forever. Yeah.
So one of the things that we looked at as we did this work early on and across the whole state, not just here in Milford, one of the things we spent a lot of time looking at is how many of these are really realistic for a student to do within the course of a year, both in terms of the amount of time that it eats up, but then also just in terms of the mental exertion that it takes students in order to really participate in really high-level performance-based tasks. So we don't, you know, it would be very difficult to have a student engage in like 8 of them throughout the course of a year. The perseverance that would take just wouldn't exist for most of our students. But we do hope to get to a point that as the performance tasks and as these approaches get stronger, there really shouldn't be a need to double assess students. If you've built a really meaningful authentic assessment that is measuring a piece of content, there really is no reason to go back and also give students a test on it. So the tricky part is when you get into the interdisciplinary concepts, finding places where the matchups go well between things like science and math and social studies and ELA, and making sure that you have connections that work well both in terms of time, but also in terms of the amount of time that it eats up in the schedule.
Yep. Something a little more small. I was lucky enough to go to the Woodrow Wilson Foundation last summer. Brian nominated me, so I was chosen as a Woodrow Wilson Fellow, and tomorrow is our follow-up. So we went, and it was all about game-like learning, they called it, but it really was performance-based assessment. So you can take a smaller unit. They told us to find one of our most boring units and insert it. So ours is the 13 colonies, because I always hear, we did this in 5th grade. So to go over it again in 8th grade, how was I going to make it more fun and challenging, focusing on, you know, three factors, economy, society, geography. We did that. I created a speed dating activity where there was 13 colonies and 13 potential colonists, and in 2-minute rounds they had to interview each other and find their perfect match. So it could be a very, it took one period. And it was, you know, a performance-based assessment.
I'm curious if Connecticut is my colony. I don't think it is.
You only get 2 minutes.
All right, well, very good. That was an awesome presentation. I think it gave us a lot of food for thought. Thank you so much for coming, all of you. Keep up the good work. Yes, Ms. Hennessy?
I'm sorry, just a comment. I want to go back and be an eighth grader in your class. Because that sounds like so much fun. That's all.
Okay, thank you so much again.
Thank you. It's a little warm in here, too.
It is.
A little bit, yeah.
So the next item on the agenda is our high school graduation date. Dates, I should say, for 2018. And if you read the agenda form, you will see that this is governed very strictly by a state law, namely that we cannot graduate before 180 school days in the school year. And while the law may say that there's exceptions, quite frankly, in my many years in Connecticut, I have never seen, I am not aware of a district that got an exception. You know, and that means, you know, Milford, the year that they had a hurricane followed by a snowstorm that knocked us out for 5 days, which means that it was December 1st and we had already missed 10 days of school. You know, I mean, it, you know, you just see things like that. Or when I was in Danbury, they had, we were delayed opening because of construction. So we missed the first 2 weeks of school, and then we had 13 snow days. You know, so we lost the April vacation. We went to, I think, June 28th. And, you know, that's the state law. So with that in mind, the law does allow us in April to set dates. You may be wondering why we didn't come to you before this, because the law says you come in April. So the way the calendar is right now, the 180th day of the school year is June 12th, and the 181st day, which is, we have 181 days in Milford in our calendar, is the 13th. So these two dates would be for the high school graduations, and as you can see, we are saying that Foreign would go on the 12th and Law would go on the 13th. The two high schools go on separate nights. This was a decision that the board made maybe 5 years ago, which would enable more board members and, quite frankly, families that might have kids in both schools be able to attend both, etc. And then what we would do is we would have the academy graduation on Monday the 11th.
What time does the academy graduate? Is that 5:15 as well?
5:15, all of them,
and
including
that's
the
great.
Middle schools.
We have a board meeting that night.
Correct, and we've done that before where we've had the academy and
last year, I think it was Harborside, graduated here on the night of our board meeting.
Right.
So we've done the academy, and it's worked. I don't remember having the academy graduation on the same night as a board meeting. I remember.
I'll double check, and I'll talk with Sarah Cianti in terms of timing.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Okay.
I mean, we can make that modification, but it pushes them then back the week before. So.
No, I don't have a problem with it as long as the timing works.
Sure.
So. Are there any questions? Mr. Pawlowski?
Do the eighth grade graduations kind of hover around the high school graduations? Is that how it
They
works.
Do, and we'll finalize that this week and get that information out to families as well as to the board. What will happen is because West Shore was delayed 3 days, their graduation is going to literally be after the high schools have graduated, and the other two middle schools have had their, you know, moving forward ceremonies. But they'll occur the week before because the high school graduate, because they're moving up ceremonies, and then what happens is that if the eighth graders then come back to school after their moving up ceremonies. But the high school, the graduations are always the last 2 days of school.
Because it is considered not really a graduation from eighth grade, correct?
Correct.
It's a moving up.
It's a moving up ceremony, that's correct.
So just to clarify, the students who graduate the first night, are they expected to come to school that following day, or no?
Sure. Mr. Brennan.
Mr. Brennan.
Not really.
Yes.
Okay, that's perfect answer, right?
The timing.
So,
the timing.
I would just leave it at that.
I mean, legally, they've already gone their 180 days.
Right.
So.
Okay, the tone said it all.
Yes,
thank you.
All right, do you have a motion, please, Mrs. Federico?
Yes, I make a motion that the Board of Education establish a graduation date of Tuesday, June 12th and Wednesday, June 13th for the senior classes of foreign and law high schools, respectively. Graduation ceremonies should begin at 5:15 p.m. for both high schools.
Is there a second?
Second.
Is there any further discussion? Okay, seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Motion carries unanimously.
Next item on the agenda is a request to be able to create a commemorative plaque in memory of Don Civitello. Some of you certainly knew Mr. Civitello. I had the good fortune of meeting him a few times. He had already been retired when I came into the district, but it was so clear that he had a profound impact on our children in this school system. So we provided a little information about Mr. Civitello. You know, he was in the Milford Public Schools for over 40 years. In all those years, he worked in special education, first as a teacher, and then as a supervisor, and then ultimately as the director. He also is very well known for having founded Camp Happiness. This was in the 1960s, which is still going on today and has grown and is expected to continue for sure. I can't tell you how many parents have talked about the quality of that program for their children. Interestingly enough, he was at Milford High School initially, and he was a coach there, football coach, and when Foreign opened, he was the first football coach at Foreign High, I believe, for about 10 years he was coach there. But the bottom line is that, you know, he passed away almost a year ago, and there are so many family members, friends, people in the community who work with him who would really like to see him be remembered because of the unbelievable impact that he had. So we have, done a lot of, thinking about what might be best and with respect to paying tribute to him. We've met with his wife, Lorraine Civitello, and spoke with her more than once. And what we've come up with, and the family is supportive, is that there would be a plaque that would be placed in the plaza outside of Joseph Foreign High School. So those of you that know Foreign High, what the original entrance to the school was is now the back of the school, where you're going up the stairs into, now they would be going into the gym area, and the art wing is down the other side, but there's a set of stairs and there's an opening there. You actually have a picture.
They do.
So you can see how much opening there is, and the thought was that we would put a plaque somewhere near where this arrow is. And when we talk about a plaque, we're talking about something that would be sort of like on a stanchion. You've seen them if you whether you're in go to the zoo or you go sometimes to outdoor museums, etc. And then you have you know, the plaque that would be there. And the reason we thought that that was the best approach is that it would allow us to actually articulate so many of the accomplishments of Mr. Civitello on that. And meanwhile, this entryway is the entrance for the Camp Happiness kids in the summertime. It's held at Foreign High. Kids go in there. You know, the thought was is that we would have the plaque there and you know, have some shrubs and a bench maybe. And just it would just be a beautiful memorial and a recognition of him. So did I leave anything out? Okay. So that, we are coming for to you, and we thought that if possible, if we could get approval tonight. I mean, we will have to come back to you with more specifics, but what it will enable us to do is at least to start to really do the research and maybe start to take steps, because the goal, if possible, is that when the Camp Happiness camp, when the camp ends this summer, that this, the dedication could occur at right before the camp ends, so that the children and the families could all be of the children could be a part of it, as well as members of the community, et cetera. Which doesn't give us a lot of time, but we think it's doable.
Okay. Any questions from the board? I think it's a great idea. It's very, very worthwhile to do. Mr. Pawlowski?
You seem to have a sense of the design that you want in hand. Do you have a sense of the cost that's going to be associated with it as well? Or is that still like being planned for, and we haven't quite figured it out?
That's being planned. Mr. Ricciatelli could talk a little bit to that. With respect to the design, the only thing we know is we'd like to have it
elevated
up. What materials are going to go into that? How, you know, how high? We haven't done any of that at all.
Yeah, we in speaking with Mr. Bradbury, that area, if you see, there's four trees in there, and those trees are actually beginning to get too big. So he was planning to do some work in this area anyway. So there'll be some groundwork that needs to be done. You can't really see it there, but there's a light there with electric, so we have to go around electric. There's also there's also some drainage areas. There's a manhole there, so there's a little bit of site work that needs to be done that we anticipate our guys probably can do on their own. But we're thinking somewhere in the range of between $8,000 to $12,000, all complete with the monument, with the groundwork that needs to be done. Plantings, bench, whatever we design to put in there.
Ms. Pinsenz?
Just out of curiosity, which line item does that come out of the budget?
It actually, we're looking to take it out of, we're looking for a grant, how we could pay for it outside of the general budget. And we do get, from time to time, we're a member of CIRMA, the Connecticut Conference of Municipalities, and then CIRMA is the group that insures us for workers' compensation and liability insurance, but it's a public nonprofit agency, and so they can't hold on to profit. So if they have excess from time to time, they'll do an equity, what they call an equity distribution to its members, and we believe that we'll be getting an equity distribution check from them that may be able to pay for at least a portion of this. So we'll be able to pay for it outside the general budget.
Any other comments or questions?
If Mrs. Burney thinks it's great, it's okay by me.
Last year was the 50th anniversary.
It was. Yeah.
Going to his funeral, it was like you would think he was a head of state. The line to get through the funeral home was around all the rooms and out the back door.
Wow.
It was unbelievable.
Mm-hmm. That's
great. All right, Ms. Federico, do you have a motion?
I do. I make a motion that the Board of Education approve the placement of a suitable memorial plaque commemorating and honoring the contributions to the children of the Milford Public Schools by Donald R. Civitello to be placed in the plaza outside of the gymnasium entrance at Joseph A. Foreign High School in accordance with Board Policy Number 7551.B.
Is Is there a second?
I wholeheartedly second that one.
Is there any further discussion? Okay, seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries unanimously.
Thank you. The next item on the agenda is four policies being brought forward to you for a first reading. So these are, the first one is policy 2111, which actually is tied to some of the others that are being brought forward to you. They're interrelated, the first three, because they all have to do with non-discrimination and in hiring practices and personnel practices in the school system. So the policy 2111 is actually a policy that is in existence as we speak. It was written originally in 1993 and hasn't been reviewed by the board since. So you see some modifications here. And what it does is it speaks to, you know, that we would act in accordance with the Equal Employment Opportunity practices by the state. And that, you know, we would move to hire staff that would help the school system be more diverse, that the staff would be reflect greater diversity. So that's why we brought this forward.
So just a general comment for the board. I did point out to Mrs. Griffin, just overall, with these policies, all of them, our general practice that the first time the board is mentioned, it should say Milford Board of Education, parentheses, the board, and then following subsequent mentions would just be the board. So she will, for the second reading, she'll make those corrections. Are there any questions or comments on this, on the policy itself? Mr. Dion.
I had two questions. The first one was the list in the first paragraph, the list of protected classes, I suppose is the proper term. Is that, did we take that from somewhere, or is that something that we?
It's new language. We didn't create that. That's new language.
But is it from like the state or from?
It comes from CADE.
Okay.
Who's pulling off of new legislation. So for example, the new term, gender identity or expression.
Yeah.
That's new, that would be language that I'm sure came through with legislation.
Okay. And are there other protected classes that we're not mentioning? Or is that just to cover it in case it goes another 25 years without being?
As well.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. And the other question I had was if there's a process in place to ensure that this policy is being met. In other words, you know, it says balanced staff designed to ensure the public schools are continuously moving toward integrated staff at all levels. Do we have anything in place that measures that or can give us any indication if we're achieving that?
Certainly, I mean, we could provide statistics on, for example, the number of people of color who apply for positions,
mm-hmm.
Which, sadly to say, are few.
Sure.
But it's also just with respect to gender balance, it's with respect to age, make sure that there's not age discrimination, and the primary responsibility is really personnel, the personnel department in terms of overseeing that, if you want to speak to it, Mrs. Capasta.
Well, we're constantly trying to reach out to make sure that we attempt to attract a balanced staff.
Sure.
It is difficult. I mean, you mentioned applicants, but we really have no way to identify a lot of these classes when you're only an applicant. It's when you're brought in for an interview, when you're down to final selections. It's a tricky area, and we're constantly trying to better ourselves in that area.
Mm-hmm.
It's a problem, not a problem, but it is an issue for many, many school districts to trying to attract minorities to come here, et cetera.
Thank you.
So it's an issue, for example, at the elementary level in particular. It's probably 95% women.
Right.
Exactly, yeah.
You know, and it's just simply because men are not going into elementary education in the way they used to. Actually, they're not going into education, period. There's been a huge decline. And so women are the dominant, gender in classrooms. So, I mean, it speaks to that as well.
Sure.
It's something that we're really we're very mindful of.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
I would think that for me, while I think it's important to strive to have a balanced staff when we're seeking, when we're making selections, it's more important to choose the best qualified candidate.
Absolutely.
Oh, I absolutely agree with that.
So it's more an issue of trying to attract
right,
people
exactly.
to come.
Right.
Yep.
Yeah,
sure.
Mr. Pawlowski?
Just a content question. On the in the first paragraph there, that last line before it's crossed out, where it says disability, it says or disability. Is that or needed there? I'm reading it now, and I'm just national origin, orientation, gender identity or expression, or disability, or any other protected status. Should that or before disability not be there?
We could check it out. It was in the language that was given to us. I thought the same thing. Why would you have or and or? But
yeah. Yeah. Okay.
But I don't think there would be any harm in reading it.
Yeah. There's just reading it. I'm like, I don't. Okay. Yeah. That's it.
We'll remove it.
Cool.
Ms. Federico,
Between this policy and the next, it seems like the list of protected classes is different. I tried to look at one and the other and see what was in one and not in the other and what was missing, and it just seems there's certain classes or descriptions that are mentioned differently between this first paragraph and then the first and second paragraph in the next policy. And I'm wondering if that's intentional.
So I wondered about the same thing if you're looking at the first paragraph, but if you look at the second paragraph,
mm-hmm.
where it says about the fourth line up from the bottom of that paragraph, it's also the policy of the Board of Education to provide for the prompt and equitable resolution of complaints, and then it goes through all the classes, and every one of those are what are in
okay.
the information. I'm not sure why it's written in such a fashion. Again, this was a policy that was recommended by Kate.
Mm-hmm.
But you can see that it has the new language, the gender identity or expression, for example. The status as a veteran, those are two pieces that were not in our existing policies.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and it just seems, sometimes they say alienage, sometimes they say ancestry, and some don't. So I don't know if that's intentional.
You're looking at the next policy, though.
I'm sorry, yes.
Can we go back? That's okay. I think I would agree that we want to try to be consistent between these two. We haven't discussed the second one yet, but we want to be consistent between the two. In terms of the terminology that we're using, if we can. So maybe when we get to the second policy, we can look at it again and or just take that for what it's worth, that we want to try to be consistent between the two. Is there anything else specific to P2111? Okay, so this will come back as a second reading next month with the changes that were suggested.
So the next policy is on non-discrimination. This is a new policy. And the opening line should not say the Board of Education will not make employment decisions. It should say the Milford Public Schools. Mm-hmm. And this is, there are, in essence, two policies here on non-discrimination, as there was in when we, this was preceded you, I apologize, but we just finished most of the student policies in the 5000s, and we did a policy on non-discrimination and then a second policy on non-discrimination tied to Americans with disabilities. So this is, again, recommendations from Kate to have a policy on non-discrimination and then specific to disabilities. So in this first one, again, you'll see much of the language that, well, we actually, to be honest with you, we did this one first and then pulled out 2111 and said, holy cow, we should make sure that the language in 2111 on equal employment opportunity mirrors that of this policy. This certainly provides more, information tied to genetic information and gender identity or expression than the previous policy. We didn't feel a need to have to repeat all of that.
I had wondered in the second paragraph, this kind of ties in with the change you made in the first line. So this is going down 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 lines. It's a very long sentence. Mm-hmm. So it starts, it is the policy of the board that any form of discrimination or harassment on the basis of, and all that stuff. And it says in that fifth line, let's see, whether by students, board employees, or third parties subject to the control of the board. So I think that should say not board employees, but employees of Milford Public Schools. And if we have board, you can have both, because the superintendent is a board employee, correct?
So you're talking about the fourth line down there?
It's actually the fifth line.
The fifth line.
One,
right,
two,
okay.
Three, four, of the fifth line of the second paragraph.
Right.
And then the language in the third paragraph, all about the genetic information. So that's required language now.
That's what I mean. This is all the new recommended policy. I can double check this with our attorney.
Okay. I wasn't clear. I was not understanding how this is relevant to our employees. The information, genetic information, I'm clueless as to how this relates to employment in the district.
I have a hypothetical situation
that
possibly could come up in a district. I'm not saying it's
right.
Milford.
Yeah.
But I have a hypothetical teacher has a parent who had,
an illness.
An illness. Where it's... I just can't think of it. Guthrie's father, Woody Guthrie.
Oh,
had
okay.
It. Okay. So Arlo Guthrie potentially could have had it too, but it doesn't express itself till later in life. And
discriminate against somebody knowing
yeah.
that they have a relative who has
yeah.
a
or
okay.
or
all
there's
right.
also genetic testing. You can get take a genetic test
mm-hmm.
to find out if you have the gene to develop this disease.
All right.
So
okay,
if you found out, anyway,
I got it now.
So I just can't think of the name of that disease that
ALS,
would
ALS? Was it ALS?
Maybe.
It was
maybe.
Lou Gehrig's disease.
Yeah.
So, all right, thank you. That explains it.
And I'll still ask our attorney about whether it's required in here.
Because you can get some genetic testing through health insurance.
This
and
is
part
a,
of it is keeping the health
uh-huh,
insurance
right,
information
yeah.
private as well.
This is a very word-heavy document.
Yeah. yeah.
Mr. Dion.
Do we have any, do we ask a question when somebody's applying about whether they've been convicted of a crime?
Yes.
Yeah.
We do.
No, not anymore. We're
no
longer allowed to ask that.
Wow.
Okay.
That just changed.
You do a background check, though,
we
right?
We had to take it off the application.
Yeah.
That's no longer allowed in the state of Connecticut.
Okay.
So but we do background checks. That's correct.
And the background checks are... pretty, I mean, I stand corrected. I forgot about the new
it
law.
It just changed not too long ago.
Yeah, is that, but the background checks are extensive.
Yes, yeah.
So it's not just Connecticut, it's federal
state and
as
federal.
Well.
Mm-hmm.
So if you do a background check and something comes up that they've been convicted, is that an automatic, you don't get to work for us?
Not automatic, but depending on what the charges were.
A level.
And, right, a level, how long ago, what it was, how it affects the safety of our staff and students.
Sure.
It could be.
So I can give an example, not in this district, but where someone applied for a position and was convicted, so I'm dating myself here, but of use of marijuana. Mm-hmm. This was on a vacation. The person was 21 years old when it happened. Boop, and it came up. So
were they hired or not?
20 years earlier. So do you turn around and say, that's it?
Right.
You were convicted, or do you look at the circumstances and say, okay, so it was 21 years of age, that, you know, they were, for life, because,
right, sure.
You know, that kind of a thing.
We actually have seen similar hypothetical issues, and I always sit down with the employee and ask them to explain, and, you know, various things can happen from there. But many people tell us up front before we run the fingerprint check,
sure.
Which is obviously the better way to handle it.
I mean, I imagine it's hard. Obviously, you can't identify every possible scenario that could happen. But in your example, I mean, it seems to me that that would make sense that that wouldn't be elegant.
More often than not, what we find on these reports is are charges that were nollied, which means they're supposed to go away, but they're still appearing. So we give the employee the heads up, and they somehow try to work the system to get it off their report, because it's really technically not supposed to be there.
Thank you.
Other questions? Mr. Pawlowski?
So do we not have a non-discrimination policy in place right now for personnel, since this is new?
We do have, we have the non-discrimination on the basis of disabilities. We did have that policy, and you'll see it's crossed out.
Mm-hmm.
And we also had it in the 5,000s, and then we had the equal employment opportunity policy. But we certainly did not have a policy that is as detailed as this is.
Okay.
So what I'm hearing you say is that you felt it was in for consistency to have a similar policy in personnel to kind of mirror the 5,000 policy for students.
I do, and you know, and again, this is no, you know, criticism, you know, of what was in place. It's just that, you know, this was 1995.
In
things
sure.
were very, very different than laws right now. So it's really updating what was in place, which is significant with respect to the next policy, and then also making sure that we've covered all bases, which is why there are now the two policies on non-discrimination.
So the way I look at this now, the equal opportunity policy kind of covers hiring, whereas the non-discrimination policy covers once you're hired. Do we know why some of these policies have two numbers on them?
Because oftentimes they're listed. You have, Pam, you actually could speak to this better than I, so go ahead.
It's for certified and uncertified staff.
Okay, all righty, thank you. Ms. Federico?
Just to go back to my earlier comment, if we could make the areas where we list the protected classes a little more consistent.
A little more consistent?
Consistent?
Between the two policies, between all three policies.
Between
the two
policies,
the 2111 and.
I think there's three times it appears in the 4118, the list of classes, and it seems to be a little different every time.
Sure.
In the order and the things that we're mentioning.
So if we're okay with the non-discrimination, then the next policy is actually a replacement of an existing policy, which is non-discrimination on the basis of disabilities. So Milford did have a policy. You can see it. It follows right after it. It's got the X over it. It was very minimal. New policy that's being brought, well, or a replacement policy that's being brought forward is much, much more detailed on disability, on the definition of disability, for example, is defined in the second paragraph in much, much more detail than that existed in 1995.
Palowski.
Thank you. In the second paragraph, the third line down, after the semicolon, we start going into performing manual tasks. And I don't know if there's just the parentheses missing, but it goes performing manual tasks, walking, seeing, hearing, eating. Should that be like a EG, IE kind of listing or?
Including.
Yeah, including something like that.
Or just a comma.
It just looks like there's something missing there.
So
I don't know if the original language, something was left out of the original language or if the original language appeared like that.
It wasn't in the original policy.
Oh, okay. So either, it would
I mean,
be
what
either.
What we sourced this from.
Okay.
Probably a comma, because I think walking, seeing, hearing, are those considered manual tasks, or is manual tasks one thing, and then walking, seeing, hearing, eating is, are different each individual items. So there might, maybe it's just a comma between tasks and walking.
I think a comma.
But if those are all separate tasks, shouldn't it be a semicolon? Since we have that as a semicolon before that. Because that would be the list. So
oh, I see, okay.
So that all the commas are part of that semicolon. Because it's the
like
list with, it's
walking,
the list within the list.
Eating, or seeing, hearing.
So what are we suggesting?
Or else caring for oneself should have a comma.
Right.
Yeah.
Caring for oneself. There should be a comma, not a semicolon.
And there should be a comma after manual task as well.
Right. So, caring for oneself, comma, performing manual tasks, comma, walking, seeing, hearing, eating, etc.
Mm-hmm.
And then in the fourth paragraph, it's the same issue with employees. With regard to its employees, the board specifically prohibits. That should be reworded in some fashion to specify that it's the employees of the Milford Public Schools are. So you could say the board specifically prohibits discrimination against Milford Public Schools employees, or with regards to Milford Public Schools employees, the board prohibits discrimination against any individual. However, it should be, however you figure that out. And then in
okay,
the.
Okay, I'll put the MPS in front of employees.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
One, two, three, four.
And then in the 1, 2, 3, this the fifth. The fifth paragraph. Again, so. It says the board, the third sentence, the board will consider any reasonable suggestion of accommodations. So that the board wouldn't be doing that. So whomever would be doing that.
Well, I think we could put Milford Public Schools.
Will consider any reasonable suggestion, okay. Actually, and then in the fourth paragraph, there's the similar situation. The last sentence, the board will afford qualified disabled individuals reasonable accommodations. That should be Milford Public Schools, too.
That's in the second paragraph as well?
Fourth.
The fourth paragraph.
Yeah, no, I'm saying it's also in the second paragraph.
Where does it say that?
The last.
Oh, the board, okay, yep.
Yeah.
The last sentence in the second paragraph, they're all the same,
yeah.
The board.
Twice in that second paragraph, the last and the second to last.
Where was the other?
Oh, I'm sorry. No,
it's
just the one, but it's in the second to last.
Oh,
so,
right, I'm sorry. You just second to last sentence, not the last sentence.
The one thing that I would just maybe pose a question to, those two examples that you gave, in the law, it speaks about the board. So so to say the board will afford qualified disabled individuals reasonable accommodations, it is the law. So granted, you're not providing the accommodations, but your policy says you basically you're following the law, or above, the board will afford qualified disabled individuals reasonable accommodations. I mean, you can say them, but this is a board policy, I guess is what I'm saying. So I understand the distinction between Milford Public School employees. You know, the hiring of Milford Public Schools employees is not necessarily something the board does, but with respect to adhering to the law, which says that, we have to afford qualified disabled individuals reasonable accommodations, I don't know. I mean, I can ask our attorney, but I don't know that the board can exonerate itself.
Well, I could see where that, I guess, in terms of, you know, if there's financial implications, then that's the board is the one that is
makes the decision.
Making yeah. decisions for the monies to be spent.
Correct.
If you could check on it,
sure.
I'd appreciate it. Are there any other questions on this policy? Okay, I guess that one's good too.
Correct, and the only other thing that I would say is that before we get into the sexual discrimination and sexual mm-hmm. harassment, we just before the new folks on the board came on board, we just passed a policy 5145.45, which is under the students, on non-discrimination. What I realized is that the same language that all of you are asking about with respect to the new pieces on gender identity or expression, et cetera, that we have to update some of this language as well. So what I'll do at the next meeting is bring forward the non-discrimination policy on students to make sure it's in sync with the ones that have been brought forward this evening.
Okay. Thank you.
All right then, so that's policies, and the next item is the human resources report. Mrs. Kapasma?
Aye.
Did
we miss
the
last
policy? Oh, yes, we missed the last policy, Dr.
I'm sorry. I'm losing it here. Okie dokie. So the last policy is on sexual discrimination and sexual harassment in the workplace. And as you can see, this is a revised and renumbered policy. So interestingly enough, this was approved in 2012, so it was 5 years ago. So a lot of the language, at least on the front page, can remain as is. But there are there's other language that needed to be included, which is the pieces in red.
Mr. Pawlowski.
Thank you. It looks to me like the language was just moved.
Is
there anything different?
Yeah, you're right. I forgot about that. We moved this out of here because you know what? Upon reading the policy, from my perspective, having the policy end with number 6, using computer systems, including email, et cetera, just seemed to, like, boom. So when I reread the policy, it just made more sense to take those paragraphs from the front page and move them to the back page.
But the language didn't change at all. Okay. I just want to make sure I didn't miss anything.
I had wondered if, in some of our other policies, so on page 2 of 3 of this policy at the bottom where it says that something should be reported to the Title IX coordinator. Other policies note who that person is. And I didn't know if that should be spelled out. The Title IX coordinator, is that you?
It is.
So who is the personnel director, whatever your title is.
I was gonna ask the same thing.
I think in other policies we've spelled that out, who that person is. Not by name, but by job title. Yes, Mr. DeYoung.
I just had a question as to why sexual discrimination and sexual harassment are included in the same policy. They seem to be two separate and very different, well, not very different, but different enough to warrant their own policy. Is there a reason why they were included in the same policy, or could we break them out into two separate policies?
I don't have an answer for that, but
I think because, well, for me, they are interrelated. One is, I mean, it says right on page 2 of 3 that sexual harassment is a form of sex discrimination.
Yeah. I just think, I think sexual harassment probably warrants its own policy.
I'm not sure if this may be following statutory language as well. That could be why they're in the same policy.
Could you look into that, Dr. Pisa? Could you look into that as to whether, maybe check with CABE if they typically put the two together or if they might have a sample policy that's different, two
sure.
separate?
CABE, you need to know that CABE reviewed this policy and wrote specifically that it's fine as is.
Uh-huh. Okay.
You know, so, but we certainly can follow up with that.
All right. Are there any other questions or comments on this one? Ms. Pinzens?
Just that the Title IX coordinator is also mentioned on page 1.
Page 1 is also,
paragraph.
Okay. I think in the other policies, it's been like at the end of the policy, the Title IX coordinator is the personnel director.
We can do that, or we can put it in both paragraphs.
If you could do whatever, be consistent with the other policies. I think some of the policies we just talked about have, you can make that decision.
Okay.
I would do what's consistent with what we've done in the other policies. And what's done in I think the 5,000 policies has the same language.
First of all, and I don't know if I've mentioned this to the new board, but the job postings are what would have been active on the website the day I did this report. So that was, I think it was last Tuesday or Wednesday. So since then, we have posted quite a number of additional jobs. We have looked at our list of retirements and resignations and posted some anticipated openings. And the reason we do that is because our budget is not yet approved. Our staffing process isn't quite done. I mean, we've looked at staffing, but that's not complete yet. But we don't want to miss out on good candidates that are out there, especially in shortage areas. So the ones that we've posted, there's 11 anticipated openings, and they cover positions such as math teachers, science teacher, guidance counselor, school psychologist, music teacher, library and media specialist, literacy coach, English teacher, tech ed teacher, the anticipated French teacher that we're going to be adding, and a special ed teacher. So I kind of wanted to explain there's a lot of openings, and you may get questioned on those. They're listed as anticipated. We didn't put down the location because we may move people and the level may change, but it's a district opening. Math teacher could be anywhere from grades 7 through 12, you know, depending on what happens with the rest of the staffing in the district. So I did want to mention that. So it's a snapshot in time, my job posting is. Also, I wanted to mention we have the superintendent of schools posting on there, which is obviously the consultant's recruitment flyer. Basically, I took the flyer, copied and pasted it in there in case somebody was on our website from elsewhere in the state or in the region or in the country, and they saw our opening. It guided them to where they would need to apply and by when. So that's why that's up there. Let's see, and I also wanted to mention, as far as retirements, because I should be reporting on this each month, we have 5 retirements for the end of the year, meaning after the school year ends, so June of 2018, and we have already had three retirements during this 2017-2018 year where they've already retired and left and been paid out their severance. So it's a total of eight when we're looking at the money for retirements for the end of the year. And I think what's average usually about
18.
So, you know, we have a ways to go, but it may or may not happen, but it's always a guess, but we do typically get our retirements in the April, May, and June range. So it's you know, it's great that when we get them early because we can plan, but it doesn't always happen.
That's it. Mr. DeYoung?
I just wanted to make a comment about Christine Kennedy.
Yes.
I was able to attend the Kids Count legislative breakfast on, was that Wednesday? Wednesday, yeah. And she was honored as the Champion of Young Children Award, I believe was the name of the actual award. Dr. Fieser was there, Mr. Burt, I'm not sure if you were there, Mr. Ricciatelli, okay. But she was honored by the mayor, by our state senator, by our state representatives, and just quite remarkable the work that she's done, and I thought the board should be made aware of that because it's not typically shouted from the rooftops about when people are honored that way. So it was I thought it was a remarkable event. And so she'll be sorely missed, I'm sure.
She definitely will be.
Thank you.
Any other comments or questions on the personnel report? Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Next item is the quarterly budget report, Mr. Ricciatelli.
Thank you, Dr. Fieser, Mr. Glenn, members of the board. As you know, we come to you once each quarter, we're at the end of the third quarter, to present to you a snapshot of the budget, where we are now, and take a glimpse of where we think we may be by the end of the year. As I say each quarter, we come to you quarterly, but we're watching the budget really on a daily basis. And especially now, as we come down toward the end of the year, we're planning for end of year expenditures, where we might have to cover deficits in certain accounts. And so we're really taking a close eye on it, you know, each and every day. So the one thing that I can report to you is that at this time, we are pretty much where we should be. We will end the year with a surplus. I just want to point out some areas on the quarterly report. In the salaries, teacher salaries, we have a surplus of about $187,000 as of today. That's about 0.4% of all of the teacher salaries, so we're pretty close to where we normally would be about this time. Teacher substitutes, we also have a healthy surplus there. And if you recall, at budget time, we talked about the district's efforts to curtail the use of substitutes wherever possible. And that's something that Mr. Burt really tackled when he came in and took a look at the number of teachers that were being pulled out of the classrooms on a weekly basis. And that's being quite curtailed, and so we're running a surplus there. And we projected, you know, the months of April and May, which are usually higher months for need for substitutes. So we're doing pretty well there. A little bit further down in the 3238 consultation services account, you'll note a slight deficit. That's where we took the superintendent search consultant from. So that's why there's a slight deficit there that will have to be covered, and we certainly will be able to cover it. In the utilities accounts, this is on page 2, the very first item, 4101, natural gas. We're running a pretty healthy surplus in that account, and we attribute that to less consumption this year because it's been a relatively mild winter. Outside of those few weeks in December around the holidays where it was bitterly cold, the rest of the winter has been fairly mild. Even though March with the snow added to our overtime budget, but in utilities at least we're doing pretty well there. In the area of transportation, the 5100 through 5111 accounts,
You'll see some accounts are in surplus, some accounts are in deficit. By the end of the by the end of the year, those will pretty much equal themselves out. And in special education transportation, if there's a deficit in that account, it is eligible for the state excess cost reimbursement grant. And so we should be fine in transportation, even though you see that there's some in deficit, and again, some that are in surplus. We are running a pretty healthy deficit in our telephone account. You'll see about $128,000. That's due, this is the first year that we were fully implemented with our voice over IP telephone system, as opposed to the old analog telephone lines. And that's reaping benefits. And in addition, because we've gone to certain technologies, and I'm not the technology person, but we're eligible for E-rate reimbursements, which are government reimbursements on telecommunications and some technology. And so we've really taken advantage of newer equipment that's eligible for E-rate reimbursements. And so that's why we're running a surplus in that account. Big deficit, as I point out each quarter, 5601, the tuition for special education. That is eligible. That happens every year, but it's eligible for the state excess cost reimbursement grant that I've explained in the past goes to the city. But if we needed to cover that account, we request it from the city, and they're required by law to give it to the board to cover that account. So that's pretty much the accounts that I wanted to bring to your attention. All of the rest, are where they should be. There are some accounts that, like professional development, you'll see that there's a decent surplus there. But that's because the professional development traditionally takes place in June, so it hasn't been booked yet, and so we haven't paid for it yet. But the vast amount of professional development takes place in the month of June and early July, and those monies will be used by the end of the year. So that's it. I'll stop there and be happy to answer any questions that you have.
Is that the same reasoning why the grounds projects hasn't really been touched as well? Is that that's mostly in the summer?
Exactly.
Okay.
Yes.
I just had two quick questions.
Sure.
When we were going through the budget process, you talked about typically somewhat at some point during the year you come back to the board and say we have a surplus of X number of dollars, and we typically assign those for building projects.
Yes.
When do you typically come?
I normally send a when we have a better idea. I normally send a memo to Dr. Fieser, who then passes it on to the board about potential projects that could be done if we have enough money at the end of the year, mm-hmm. and we ask the board to take a look at it and see if there's any objections. That's usually about the third week in May.
Okay.
And then I would come to you at the June meeting, your regular June meeting, and ask for board transfers. And that's really where we have a very good picture of where we're going to be. And we ask for transfers into certain accounts that would allow us to do those summer projects. And then at the July meeting, we end the year where you come back and you actually close everything out.
Okay. All right. That makes sense. And then the only other question I had was on the 8200s.
Mm-hmm.
So 8200 on the nose is student activities, 108575.
Yes.
And then 8201 to 8209 is all athletics. Is there a number that we're working with? I mean, if you add up all the student athletics, it's 263,000. Is there a number that we're working with for student athletics overall? Or are they always broken out that way?
It's always broken out this way, but if you look in your budget book, which I don't have with me here tonight,
that's okay.
But you'll see exactly how much is the total amount that's budgeted per high school for all of these items. And then you'll also see broken out how much is set aside for each high school for game day operations.
Right.
So. What you see here is the total amount broken into those accounts, but it's for both high schools.
Okay.
You can see the total amount in the budget book. That's it, it's equal amount for both high schools.
But the, and the activities number is for both high schools too? Or does that also include middle school?
Student activities includes all schools.
All schools. Okay. Thank you.
Sure.
On the athletics, you should also know that there's an annual report that's provided to the board in November.
I think we saw that.
I think
some
board members were here before
that. Yeah. Yeah.
I think I
before they were. It's a page turner.
Just if you could clarify on the tuition special ed non-public 5601, the negative amount there. You said it can either come from money from the state grant that we asked the city for.
Yes.
Or it's covered by our surplus lines.
Yes.
Okay.
In the past, we would make a determination of how much money, how much total deficit there is for special education. And then we would take a look at if we have a surplus, how much of that surplus we would dedicate toward closing that gap, and then how much money we would request from the city.
Okay, so we start by looking at special education in general.
Yes.
Okay. And then, so let's say we have a surplus in teacher salary, as we talked about in the beginning. How would we decide if we wanted to put that money towards this gap or towards buildings and grounds?
Well, we would come to you. That's
what we do
the board
right.
transfer. That's the board transfer
right.
meeting where
right,
we would
right.
propose to you how administration would recommend to spend any particular surplus. Excuse me. Normally, the excess cost money that comes from the state pretty much covers the deficit, and so we're able to ask the city for a certain amount of it. In some cases, the city has budgeted for more than what we asked them for, so it ends up being a slight surplus on the, in the city's revenue account. But it depends at the end of the year. We have to add up all of the special education bills that we get, and then see how it breaks into the formula for 4.5 times the amount over what
okay.
we had budgeted for. Then the state will tell us what they're reimbursing us for, and then we have to decide how much of that we want back from the city.
Okay. So, but typically you look at the special education bucket as a whole, separately from the other items when you're making that determination. Because I know we ultimately vote, but you typically come to us with a recommendation.
Right.
Yes.
Correct.
We would come to you with a recommendation, and we're looking at the, when we talk about the deficit in special education, it's the special education tuitions for outside placements. That's
and transportation.
And in transportation for outside placements, correct. That's what's eligible for excess costs.
Okay.
So we wouldn't, there isn't going to be a surplus in other special education items. There just isn't. Normally, because of the volatility and unpredictability of special education, there's not monies left over in surplus there to cover these line items. And so typically we have to go to the excess cost money instead.
Okay. So if I could just ask then, the tuition special ed public, the line above it that currently has a $374,000 surplus, you're saying that's not going to stay?
Yes. Well, right now that's where it is.
Okay.
A student could come into the district tomorrow.
Okay.
And it would cost us money. But right now we're predicting that if the year were to end now, that we have $375,000 in that account, which would go toward offsetting the line below.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. Great. Thank you.
Sure. Any other questions? All right.
And then the last report is the dispersal report.
You have in your package the list of all disbursements for the month of March that are over $1,500, and I'll be happy to answer any questions that you have.
Any questions on the list?
Just a couple quick ones.
Yes, Mr. Arnold.
On line or number 196198, it's the Board of Ed contribution, LAP premium. Just what is LAP?
Liability and property insurance.
Again, on the second page, 195-953, the influenza vaccine supplies.
Yes.
Doesn't the, does, do insurance companies carry, you know, cover that, or does that get reimbursed at all?
No, we our employees get the vaccine, and some, and also some of our students do, and we buy that. The health department buys it, and then we reimburse them for it. We have a budget for it each year.
Gotcha. The final question again. Mm-hmm. On the last page, 196-099, reimbursement for consulting work with S. Just seems a little incomplete.
Yeah, give me that line number again, please.
196-099. Last page.
It's page 29 of the packet.
Page 29 of the packet.
Okay, 29. Sure. That, I think there's missing an initial there, but that is a direct reimbursement for work with a student, and so we never refer to a student by name, it's always by initial.
Gotcha.
I'm sure that there's an initial missing there.
Might be S for student.
Yeah.
That's it, Mr. Arnold. Any other questions on this? All right. Thank you. We'll move on to consent agenda. Ms. Federico.
I move that the Milford Board of Education approves consent agenda items, consideration of minutes from the March 12th, 2018 business meeting, and the March 26, 2018 special meeting.
Your second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries unanimously. All right, we had no new business. Is there any board comment tonight? Mr. DeYoung?
I just wanted to share a quick experience that I was lucky to have at Orange Avenue School. I guess this was Tuesday, of 2 weeks ago, two Tuesdays ago. They do a program called Get Caught Reading, which invites members of the public. Some of you may have done it, I don't know. But I know Dr. Fieser was there. I'm not sure who else from the district. I saw Mr. Bradbury there. Some of our aldermen were there. So I went into Ms. DiRienzo's third grade class. I read The Giving Tree, and we put together friendship bracelets with the kids. It was a really terrific, terrific experience. And the kids, you know, last meeting they were talking. You guys were talking about, you know, going into the classrooms and being amazed at what the kids are asking. I had a similar experience. It was only third grade, and these kids were asking really in depth and questions about the characters and giving answers also about the characters and the plot, the story, which there isn't a huge plot in that story, but you know enough where it was, you know, impressive to me. So it's a great program. I don't know if it happens in the other elementary schools, does it?
Yes, it's all celebrating reading.
Yeah.
And also Dr. Seuss, you know, et cetera.
It's part of that, okay.
Yes.
So it was a really great program, and there were a lot of our colleagues that we're all, you know, potentially friendly with throughout the city that were there. I'm sure the mayor did at some point go. It was a terrific event, and I think the folks at Orange Ave should be applauded. I know it's something that they do every year, I suppose. And so I was really pleased to be able to participate in it. I think we should consider, you know, thinking about how we can expand some of these programs into other schools at some point.
They are done in all the schools.
They are done.
The reading is done in all the schools. I've been invited to other schools.
Oh, okay.
So they're done at different times of the year.
Okay.
Potentially. So yeah.
Well, it was a great program. So.
Any other comment? Okay, seeing none, motion to adjourn.
I make a motion to adjourn.
I'll second that.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries unanimously. Thank you so much.